So her topic is mining sector in Myanmar, making sense of resource conflict.
Good afternoon, everybody. Apart from the others, I would like to thank especially Professor S. Chandrasekhar, who has helped me in this presentation. Thank you, sir. My topic is mining sector in Myanmar, making sense of resource conflict. So this is how the format of the presentation. I would like to look at this resource conflict through Mackinder's heartland theory. The resource details through maps, historical origin of the ethnic conflict, where I'll be briefly discussing about the Panglong Agreement, the overview of the ethnic conflict and the status of it till date, the counterinsurgency operations adopted by the Myanmar government, and some probable questions. So what exactly is this theory all about? It's a theory of geopolitical relation proposed by Halford J. Mackinder in the form of an article, the title of which is The Geographical Pivot of History, which was submitted to the Royal Geographical Society in 1904. So what does this theory talk about? It tells that whoever controls the Eastern Europe controls the quote-unquote world island, which comprises Asia, Europe, and Africa, and then ultimately the entire world. So why East Europe? Because it has large volume of resources. So how does it look like? So as you can see, if you have the Eastern Europe here, and if you can control this, then you'll be able to control Africa, Asia, and Europe. So if I try to look this through our current topic. So this is the administrative map of Myanmar. As we are aware of, and as my earlier speakers have clearly specified, the difference between division and states. States are the peripheral areas inhabited by the minority ethnic groups, and the central region, the divisions, which are mostly inhabited by the majority Burmans. So if I try to superimpose this administrative map onto the ethnic map, how does it look like? It looks somewhat like this. So we have the central region, the white portion, which comprises the majority Burmans, and also down south. Rest of the peripheral areas are all inhabited by the minorities. So since we are talking about mining and resources, I thought of stating how important this ministry is. So this ministry, the organizational chart of the ministry looks somewhat like this. It has got 6 enterprises and 2 departments. Each of the enterprise has been allotted a specific set of resources which they are supervised to look after. Like mining enterprise number 1 looks after lead, zinc, silver, copper, iron, nickel, chromite, antimony. 2, gold, tin, tungsten, rare earth, titanium, and platinum. 3, coal, limestone, industrial minerals, manganese, decorative stone. Myanmar Gems Enterprise looks after gems, jade, and jewelry. Salt and Marine Chemical Enterprise looks after salt. Pearl Enterprise, pearl breeding, cultivating. So there are 2 departments apart from these 6 enterprises. One is the Geological Survey, which looks after the exploration, and the Department of Mines, which is responsible for the policy formulation. So the Ministry of Mines has categorized the various available resources in Myanmar in these various categories. So under the very rich category falls jade, ruby, sapphire, limestone, rich, copper, lead, zinc, tin, tungsten, gold, coal, and barite. Fairly rich, antimony, silver, nickel, gypsum, iron, manganese, and poor, chromite, PGM, that is platinum group minerals, radioactive minerals, diamond, fertilizer minerals, etc. So, keeping our earlier theory in mind and these maps, this is actually the map looks like the resources. So, if I try to look each of these resources through maps and keep our earlier theory in mind, how does it look like? As you can see, the central region, once again, has maximum of these copper deposits. Rest of the periphery looks blank. Next, if we go to the iron deposit, once again, it obviously this has got a mixed location. Both the central region as well as the peripheral, which is the Shan state, has maximum of these deposits. Also some here down south. Lead, zinc, silver, similar case. It has got mixed maximum in the Shan state and in the central region. The nickel deposit, once again, it has very limited resources, but whatever is we find in the mixed, both in the central as well as in the peripheral areas. The antimony deposits, once again, maximum in the central region and also the region down south. Gold, platinum, once again, maximum in the central region. Manganese deposit, whatever we have mixed in the central region. The important ones are listed here and some others here. So, similarly, chromite. Coal deposit, once again, as you can see, the concentration here in these areas in maximum. Limestone. So, one part we have the theory, the second we have the geographical location of these resources. So what actually is interesting and fascinating when we try to look the theory and the geography and take the history into account, we'll find that we cannot look each of these elements separately. We have to kind of keep these three elements into alignment and try to figure out what actually this ethnic conflict is all about. So just before moving further, I would like to briefly discuss the historical origin of this ethnic conflict. So British divided Burma into two administrative divisions. One is the ministerial Burma and another is the frontier areas. So British sided with the minorities and neglect the Burmans when it colonized the country in 1886. Burmans, naturally, the majority Burmans equated the colonial rule with that of the minorities. During World War II, Japan occupied Burma with the help of the ethnic Burmans. However, the realization that British as colonial masters were better than the Japanese prompted the majority Burmans to seek support of the British. As a next step, the three groups, the majority Burmans, the minority ethnic groups, as well as the British, collaborated to overthrow the Japanese rule. Eventually, Burma achieved its independence in 1948. However, it is necessary here to briefly discuss about the Panglong Agreement. So March 1946, first Panglong Conference was held in the Shan State. The British Director of the Frontier Areas, H.N.C. Stevenson, proposed United Frontier Union of Chin, Kachin, Shan, Karini and Karen ethnic groups. However, this was rejected by the father of Myanmar, Aung San, who at that point of time led anti-fascist People's Freedom League. Naturally, there was a need for a second Panglong Conference, which was held on February 12, 1947. Some of the foundational principles like internal autonomy, right to secession, and possibility of creation of a separate Kachin state were agreed upon. Later on, this 12th February was celebrated and is till date celebrated as the Union Day every year. However, it was a kind of temporary agreement reached with the provision to secede from Burma after 10 years. Now, as one of the speakers earlier in the morning session pointed out, that if we take the situation hypothetically, had Aung San not been assassinated on 19 July, would the situations been different? Because the provisions of the Panglong Agreement may have been implemented. So what is the status of the conflict so far? So there are more than 135 ethnic groups, which are divided into 8 major divisions. The numbers in the bracket are the subgroups. So the 8 major divisions are Bamar, which has 9 subgroups: Chin 53, Kachin 12, Karen 11, Kaya 9, Mon 1, Rakhine 7, Shan 33, and unofficially there are 36 ethnic groups. So there are various reasons of origin. If we take all the papers into account, then it starts from independence to autonomy to control of resources, of commodities. And how do these various ethnic rebel groups sustain themselves? They do so mainly through drugs, but also illegal taxation, bribery, forced labor, and expropriation of farmland. So till 1988, these groups wield enormous power and control. Post-1988, ceasefire agreements were signed individually with these groups. However, they were given two conditions: to retain their arms and to partially control their territory. By 1996, the government had signed peace treaties with some of these ethnic groups. However, 2008, a new constitution came up in which Article 340 has a kind of a tricky provision, which said that the military has the right to operate these private militias. Also, there was another point of these border guard forces, transformation of these private militias into border guard forces, which till date, obviously, all the groups have declined. So, if we take the counterinsurgency operations, then we will find that Myanmar government has adopted two types of counterinsurgency operation to deal with this conflict. One is conflict settlement. So, under conflict settlement, we find that continuing from my previous slide, that the peace talks began after President Thein Sein came to power in 2011. There were two groups. So earlier, individual agreements were signed with each of these rebel groups. But now there was an attempt to draft a national ceasefire agreement. So there were two groups. One was the government's union peace working group, and another is the national ceasefire coordination team. So by 2nd February 2015, almost all the rebel groups declared that they're ready to participate in the 60th anniversary of the Union Day if the government agrees to call for Union Nationalities Federation Council. And as we are all aware of that, on 31st March, the draft agreement was signed between 16 armed ethnic groups and the government. However, two groups, one is the Tang National Liberation Army and Kokan groups, have still refused to sign it. The second part of the counterinsurgency operation, which is the conflict containment, there were two specific policies adopted by the government. One was the four cuts doctrine, which Dr. Behra has earlier mentioned in his presentation. I would just briefly say that to deny the ethnic armed groups access to food, financial support, intelligence and recruits by driving the civilian population from areas where they could support these groups. So it's basically kind of a wall limitation strategy where you geographically limit the rebel groups to a particular area, and thereby it becomes easier for the military to deal with the crisis. The second was the color code classification system. By this, Myanmar labeled how to deal with each of the groups after labeling them in colors. There were three colors, black, brown or white, based on the extent of government control. The black areas have been those in which government control is weak, brown where government control is challenged, and white where government control is strong. So how does it look like on a map? It looks somewhat like this. It's not white, basically. So these are the areas, as you can see, there's this thing. So the black areas, brown and white zones. So before we move on to our probable questions, I would like to say that keeping a theory in mind, we could have very well concluded that since the central region is where the maximum resources are located, and also where the majority Burmans stay. So we could very well have concluded that the majority Burmans would have succeeded in defeating these rebel groups. But in the last 60 years, we have not found so. So what actually is the scenario that has prompted the government to bring the rebel groups across the table instead of dealing with the crisis in a military way? That means the rebel groups equally had powerful bargaining chip to force the government to come across the table. So before we move on to some questions, I would like to make some observation. As my earlier speaker has already clarified, the Resource Watch Institute has listed ranked 58 out of 58 countries, Myanmar, in the 2008 Resource Governance Index. And the reasons they have stated are high level of corruption, extremely low level of accountability of expenditure of resource revenue, ineffectual regulation, and the absence of institutional oversight of natural resource projects. However, in July 2014, ma'am knows it very well, that EITI's board approved Myanmar's candidate status, thereby proving some sign of improvement. Second, arms procurement as a component of gross military expenditure has increased, as listed by SIPRI. China being the major arms exporter with 45%, 69% and 58% in 2011, 12 and 2013 respectively. So what actually is everyone talking about this conflict thing? So the government blamed poverty as the driver of insurgency and has thereby pursued economic development without any kind of accountability. Economic development is actually benefiting the government officials. That is what the insurgent groups are saying. But it will not solve the conflict unless the demands of ethnic minorities are properly addressed. So on one particular topic, we have two different views. Once again, government feels that any kind on the issue of revenue sharing, also there are some conflicting views by the government as well as the rebel groups. Government feels that any kind of revenue sharing by it would be used by the rebel groups to fund the conflict. The rebels, on the other hand, are targeting the infrastructure projects, which they consider as the chief finance provider to the Tatmadaw military modernization. So substantial flow of FDI after it opened up in 2011 without adequate accountability is actually increasing the scope of the conflict. So this is how, this is a map by National Geography, which has shown the exploitation and the displacement which is causing since 2011 because of this unaccountable FDI flows. As you can see, Burmese refugees in Bangladeshi camps, Burmese refugees in Thai camps, internally displaced persons in southeastern Burma, then you have, because of Mitsun Dam, there are these many number of people who are displaced. So there are some questions which we need to answer. One is, even if the heartland, as per the theory, is controlled by the majority Burmans, the minorities equally have a bargaining chip. And that is the country's rich natural resources. So the peripheral areas are not only controlled by the rebel groups, but those are the areas where we have the natural resources as well. So we need to find out some kind of a middle ground where both the demands of the government, the rebel groups, as well as a third party who wants to invest in these areas, find a way. The scenario would have been different had the rebel groups not been strong enough to bring the government across the table. So here we cannot just throw away one group and support the other. We have to keep both the army, ethnic groups, the government and the other investors into account, take them into account. So can we really say, is it a resource conflict or an ethnic conflict? I mean, leave that to the audience. What is the status on the question of revenue sharing? Even after the draft agreement, we are not clear what exactly is the point of view on this revenue sharing. So the issues revolve around who produces and who appropriates them. With a perpetual conflict scenario brewing, what would a foreign country interested in investment do? With whom, basically, who are the major players? With whom are the third party going to interact? So it appears that this draft is a kind of a convenient status quo arrived at both before the election to put up a united show before the international fraternity, which in turn would be able to vindicate its stance on Myanmar. So, thank you.